The excitement that has encompassed the unveiling of the final investment decision in the oil and gas sector is one that has created a lot of hope for Uganda to finally see a drop of the first oil come 2025. The big question, however, is just how prepared are the players, mostly in the private sector, to take up this opportunity and also benefit from the sector that several Ugandans have for years waited to see what they can get from the oil and gas sector. Good evening and welcome to The Business Show. My name is Simon. Once again, welcome to the show. Now, time to run you through stories that are making headlines in the world of business locally and across the globe. MTN to invest 1 trillion shillings in the network coverage across the country. Uganda to send youth to ICT Expo happening in Dubai. EU offers 11.9 billion shillings to support small and medium businesses in the country. And India to launch digital rupee in 2022.
You're supposed to confirm the other market. You may actually find that the market is still there, but in between Rwanda changed the standards and specifications.
Even if you have something good inside there, when the branding and the packaging is not attractive, you will not sell the price.
The highly anticipated reopening of the Gatuna border has created excitement for businesses and of course a leeway for Uganda Revenue Authority to start thinking of collecting some revenue from exports to boost the revenue collection for the country. We know for a fact that already, they have a target of 25 trillion shillings for the financial year 2022-2023, which means they will have to squeeze some businesses as well to make this money. The big question, however, is can they collect this money without affecting the businesses that are slowly recovering from COVID-19? Tonight in Views from the Top, we speak to Dr. Fred Muhumza, a lecturer at Makerere University, who weighs in on this, plus what does the final investment decision in the oil and gas sector mean for the country.
Opening of the Rwanda-Uganda border has many implications. There is the business side, of course, but also there is the political side, because we don't believe it was closed due to business. It was more with the politics. So opening sends a signal to the business community that something has been going on to reach that level, to resolve the political reasons why the border was closed, because those are usually more important to the business community. But let's not forget that the people who used to trade along that border made heavy investments in order to produce whatever they are selling. Others invest in the logistics of selling to the Rwanda market and the Ugandan market. Now, such an opening needs to give them kind of a longer term perspective. You don't want to go back and begin to dust your factory, re-import the equipment you're putting in, revive all your networks, and then the problem is back within 3 months. So since there was a political aspect, this opening now sends that signal that maybe the political differences have been ironed out. And those happen behind the scenes. So that is one positive side that people will be waiting to see whether it will take that long. But in terms of trade, it was real big trade, really. Because when you look at the numbers before, you were talking about $250 to $270 million per year. Divide that by 12, you're talking about 20 to 25 million dollars a month. That's quite significant trade for a country like Uganda. Now, after the closure, that came down to literally less than $10 million a year. So you can see the loss in terms of revenue, foreign exchange for Ugandans, but also knowing the nature of trade there, a lot of it was really integrating the communities, because it was local food. Some of it could have been re-exports, but originally they are originating from Chikubo area. These are Ugandan manufacturing companies, some of them like roofings were selling there, construction materials. Your people are selling bread and many other things which are really speaking to the integration of the economy. So the reopening now brings hope to those business persons, the ones they employ, and we can only hope that it will be sustained for a longer period and completely become as neutral as it was before.
All right, so 2 years is certainly a long time, and there's so much that has changed. How should the business community then, you know, slowly get back into what was?
Now, that's the other thing, actually, is good you've raised that. What was may not even come back, because 2 years is a long time. You may have been selling there a product that somebody else now filled the gap by beginning to manufacture from Rwanda itself. So not everybody should be excited. The border is open, I'm going back where I was. They need to first cross over. They need to first assess the market, because you cannot tell me the Rwandans have not been eating bread, that Rwandans have not been constructing. They have now alternative sources. So you want to find out while we were away, what else they begin to use. When you look at the poultry business, you begin to see the dynamics. Because now reading through, I think it was the East African, one of the journalists really assessed the situation and realized that people are buying poultry from Uganda, taking it to Kenya, and then flying it over to Rwanda. But originally, they were directly doing the trade.
Yes.
So they didn't lose the business, but they added on another leg to say, let's change the source. We are now coming from Kenya into Rwanda. We are no longer Ugandans. But they would actually ship their chicken through, or even drive through, or go by lake, whichever other means they were using. So anybody who was in that business needs to come back and see, 2 years down the road, what has changed. Do I still have the business as it was, or have my partners found other alternative sources and moved on? If I'm to get them back, what do I need to do? So it's not just that the border is open, get things on the truck and cross. People need to really look at what has changed and how do I re-engineer myself back to the old days, or even better, maybe find something else to do.
You know, talk about putting things on the truck and going. The question would be then, should someone, let's say an exporter, get so carried away and, you know, look for money on the side and really buffer their business and start pushing things, or there is just something else they need to pay more attention to?
As exporters, as you said, you want to first understand whether the market is there. And thank God you're talking about exporters, because exporters, you're supposed to confirm the other market. You may actually find that the market is still there, but in between, Rwanda changed the standards and specifications. So you can no longer just walk in with your rice, aflatoxins on maize. Maybe then that was not there, but in between, Rwanda was not sleeping. They have changed those dynamics. But also the Ugandan side, for us, we're importing some things from there. Does it mean the Rwandan should just come, or Ugandan should just go and pick whatever they were bringing this side that was coming in from Rwanda? The market is always dynamic, because the people will always find look for different options. So any trader along that border, before you get the truck and move across, you need to watch two things, or maybe even more than two. One, does that market still exist the way it was? If anything has changed, how do I plan to adapt to the new changes? Because the new change might mean somebody took the market and is now supplying them from Tanzania, or is supplying them from Congo, or from some other country. So in which case, you are going to compete with that other person who was not there, but now became a player in that space. Two, again, it was good it happened on the first day. Everybody was excited. The border is open. I hear people had already booked bus tickets. Yeah. And paid. Now you come, no, it is only for essential movements. Now essential movement means what? It might mean cargo, but what type of cargo? So you really want to first understand, and that's why I don't want anybody to rush, because you can reach there, you're taking eggs, and they tell you, no, eggs are not allowed here. The real chicken finished is allowed, or chicken feeds, because Rwanda itself might have decided, let me nurture my local poultry industry, so all I need from Uganda is not eggs and not chicken, but poultry feeds. So you want to understand that dynamic before you load and run there. So let's first watch, but as we are saying, we are praying that it will remain open and fully get open.
All right, you talked about some figures at the start, really, about the performance of the two countries. And one would then say, now that we're open, if we continue, probably make some money that can help the country recover. Let's talk a bit about URA then. And if anything to go by, the 25 trillion they're supposed to, or they're mandated to collect, is it a good step to start from?
It is certainly a good step to look forward to. because already they have the 25 trillion as a task. They must find it from wherever they can and from whatever opportunities that they can. We have already said here is trade of about $250 to $270 million. Not all of it may come back in this year to benefit URA on their target, but they need to be watching that space. Now you might find some of the traders will take even longer to come in and pick anything. But the good thing is the target of 25 trillion is on next year, which begins in July. So by then we'll have assessed how fast the trade has come back. How do you tax it? But also you don't want to tax because it's just back, you might kill it.
Yeah.
So you want also to consider some things. But some additional hope that can help to close the gap or any other journey that they need to walk towards the 25 trillion shilling mark. So it's something they should look forward to. But also, as we say, there is a lot more. There are factories that are going to come back, which were supplying the Rwanda market. They may make a profit, you also earn something from there. So it's not just the trade of what's crossing the border, but also the people making it, the people engaged in that service. So URA needs also to facilitate the recovery of those individuals, because it is in their interest to make sure they come back. We now have seen disruptions due to COVID, crossing borders. We need to quickly learn and not make mistakes that we have seen in Malaba and Busia. So these are tracks. What do you do? But also, that's a good thing to also bring into the picture. What if another COVID wave comes, either here or the other side? It will disrupt the flow. So you want to put in all those contingencies in your parameters of watch and say, how do I secure the journey to the 25 trillion? So URA has some work to do, but also it's not working alone, it needs to engage its partners. This is where URA and foreign service must always sit and talk. And people engaged in the production and trade in Uganda. Some of these may be security matters, fine, those ones are above us. But even then, you want to put your case to the security people. To say, can we use diplomacy? We have all seen the standoff between Ukraine and Russia. It is a security situation. But because of the trade with the European Union and Russia and others, they are trying to engage as much diplomacy to avoid the real end of the journey, which is, can be very, very tight.
All right, you talked about COVID, and we know the fact that businesses are just recovering, and URA domestically is supposed to get some money from them.
Yes.
Would one be right to argue that, you know, we probably give these businesses some holiday so they can recover, and then we start taxing them again, or we go from the word go and get the money?
You know, taxation is a part and parcel of the entire ecosystem of the economy. Some of the businesses survive on the strength of the households, which also needs to recover. So URA, much as it wants to look at the businesses and work on a recovery strategy for the businesses, and I think this is one area where Uganda haven't worked very well. We've been targeting the businesses, but we forget the businesses produce for the households. If the households do not buy because they haven't recovered, that is going to be passed on as a cascading effect on the businesses themselves. So we should also be interested in saying, well, the businesses haven't recovered fully, but possibly because the households haven't recovered. The businesses are ready to produce, the motors can run,
yeah,
produce the goods. But for every 100 goods they produce, which they used to sell, now when they produce 100, they sell 40. So they have reduced their production. And so the problem is not the business, but rather the market. Now, that may not be entirely URA's role, but URA being part of government should be able to make recommendations and engage the space of the actual entities of government responsible for household incomes. You're talking about agriculture, you're talking about others like infrastructure, you're talking about even the manufacturing itself, small businesses, because this is where the households come. Ugandan businesses are linked with households,
yeah,
majority of them, because they are informal. So when I see people chase away the hawkers, I'm like, do they know what impact they are doing to the very businesses,
yes,
that make the products that the hawkers sell? Because the hawker is the last mile. The hawker doesn't make that product. But because he was closer to the market, he was helping a large business,
yeah,
reach out to its customers. So that is a disruption that people are not seeing. Now, I would be saying, fine, the hawkers don't have to pay tax, but they are helping a business that pays the tax. That's why I was saying it's an ecosystem, and you need to understand the nature of the business. But even in Uganda, we have said, let's do more with business taxes, consumption taxes. If the hawker doesn't pay tax, but he's selling soda and water on which already there is a tax, so that transaction on the street is already contributing to taxes, because there is some VAT, there is some excise duty on that transaction. The product being exchanged has a tax on it. So whether the hawker pays, let me grab the other one of the person buying the product.
Yes.
Because I need that revenue. But also when that revenue comes through, the company will make a profit, I will also go for it. So I think that argument of remove the hawkers because they don't pay tax was completely a non-starter.
Final investment decision, which has been huge talk.
Very interesting, yeah.
Your take?
Final investment decision has been long awaited. But as we've said, you need to really unpack it. I hear 15, 16, 20, all sorts of billions of dollars. Now, knowing very well from our history, you want to catch and say, of these things that are going to be part of the 15 billion, the 20 billion, how much of this is Ugandan made? If the cement quality required has to come from Bamburi, Kenya, you begin to count your losses. If a big component of it is the high-level engineers and technicians who Uganda, which who are not in Uganda, you begin to count your leakages in the economics. So you want to say, of this, how much will remain in Uganda? So you see the shortfall that we would have incurred had we developed our raw materials, that all the steel and iron going to be used will be coming from Moko Kabale. All the cement that's going to be used will be coming from Tororo, Hima, and these other entities. The cement might also be imported, because the quality of cement you need, the steel you need, the human resource that you need. Then, as they have said, Ugandans begin, the ones who are selling pineapples there. We all know the price of a pineapple is 1,000. So out of that money, you want to unpack it and say, now the FID is coming, what is going to remain in Uganda? Because you don't want to just wait for the oil to flow. You should already have captured some upfront benefits. And I want to understand those dynamics. I know the companies that listed on the portal, out of which they are supposed to select companies to provide services, very few are Ugandan companies. So already the FID might give us some benefits, but less than what is possibly being praised and talked about. But also, in the agreements, part of these investments are recoverable costs. So 15 billion is going to come in, 15 billion will go out at some point. So the point is, what impact has it done while it was still around? Which is the conversation we are having. If much of this is going to go to China, it's going to go to France, Europe, and what, because that's where the raw materials and investments are going to come from, physical investment plus personnel, then you're going to have a problem working out, where are we? What did I get out of this?
Well, so we know for a fact that $270 million every year is what Uganda was exporting to Rwanda before the closure of the border 3 years ago. We can now hope that with the partial reopening, we can fully see a bit of business coming back again to support the country, raise the money, knowing that, well, we have the full reopening of the economy, which is on now. And of course, we expect some money to support the 2022-2023 national budget. You're watching The Business Show with me, Simon, sitting in for Viola. Time now for a quick break. When we get back, we'll be telling you what's happening in how to make money. You need to watch this. Stay with us.